Not sure if it's will stay there. I think it's just need to put it.
Shit.
This.
Okay, retreated.
So Gemma, can you just come be a photo assistant for a bit while?
I don't want. I don't.
It's a piece of leaf.
Okay.
No, creepy.
I want.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, again.
Okay, so we are recording, right? If you can come and sit here, then we can.
Okay.
So when it's recording.
Face the camera.
Yeah, it's fine. We're capturing the interaction.
So if you want to just talk about what you do on campus, and as you know that this is to, in order to, can you try putting that on, the idea is to actually have a very small piece so that it could maybe sit on.
Sorry, it's on an inch.
Yeah, I know, because I thought a little.
Okay.
Yeah. The idea is to figure out, you know, the large question that we're all engaged with after COP21 is over, and with the environmental challenges that we face, how do we measurably improve human and environmental health at Connecticut College, given that, you know, the idea of the university college is that there's some sort of duty or raison d'etre of intellectual leadership that we should be exploring and experimenting with new ideas and figuring out
from an environmental perspective.
Yeah, how do we redesign our relationship to natural systems collectively, right? And
I don't want to complain about the college's program, but there's a lot of things they need.
Right,
and I think that's why my name may have come up.
Right,
because I've been pushing for some things.
Right. Well, so I suppose that's the. You've got some experience here, you know, your expertise, things that you've done, sounds like at home and in the.
In the technology arena here on campus.
Yes.
And the things we've done.
Yes. So what I'd like to discuss is there's a few projects that we've kind of been thinking about, and the opportunity to figure out what it is, how your expertise can contribute to improving the environmental performance of Connecticut College.
Of Connecticut College.
Yeah, and the way I frame it in terms of human and environmental health, as opposed to sustainability or, you know, energy savings or any of that. We really measurably want to improve human and environmental health. And what ways do we have to do that, right, in your. So first of all, introduce yourself and your role as
okay.
a college. Yeah.
Okay. My name is Jean Daly, and I am the Assistant Vice President for, it's called Enterprise and Technical Systems here on campus. So I have a team of 30-odd people that actually run the computer systems on campus, from the networking and data center, the software, enterprise software, the desktops, the web, and so all that falls under my responsibility and my direction. And I have a great team.
Yes,
all of that.
That's so exciting.
Yeah,
because one of the big ideas is that we couple. Great, and how does that sit on the skin? Okay, one of the big ideas is that we use. That actually is not very sticky, is it?
Well, but the other side maybe. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Do you want to try that?
I can't get them off.
One of the big ideas is how to use our contemporary infrastructure, cloud data storage, the fastest growing sector of the economy is the digital realm, and how do we design our digital infrastructure in such a way that not only does it, you know, is it more efficient, does less damage?
Well, there's a lot of different ways in the information technology thing. Over the years, the 30 plus years I've been in information technology, the computers have reduced substantially in size. They take substantially less energy to run them. And at the same, and they've reduced, you know, size, energy, but also the need for like air conditioning and all those types of right. things that we used to need have been substantially reduced. So we've taken advantage of that here at Connecticut College. We're moving into a new data center over the winter break where we'll have all the environmental needs that conditions that we need for a data center, and but with a reduced footprint.
Where is that?
And the new data center
yeah.
is will be in the Shane Library. The room is ready. We'll just be moving our data servers, virtual servers, over there over the winter break.
So all of the data servers for the university will be in that one room?
For the enterprise.
For the running the administration.
For running the administration. But there are different pockets, like in computer science, that they run their own servers and stuff.
So we're going to talk and try and photograph it. I try and balance. Do you mind if I try and put the frog on your head? He's sitting quite quietly.
Yeah, no problem at all.
Like a perfect sport. This is great. Because, okay, now that I've said that, he's going to start, he's starting to get active. This is, oh, so he wants to sit on your head, you see?
Yeah.
Come on, sweet guy. So this is actually an Australian tree frog. We've tried to get
ready to stay up.
That's so sweet. You've got to see it.
I wish I could, but yeah. I don't want to move because I don't want him to fall. So what else have we done from an information technology perspective? We're always looking at ways to reduce our footprint. So we've undertaken recently, we've done a lot of service, software as a service, where we actually don't run the servers here. The software actually and the data is being stored offsite at third-party vendors.
Okay, so let's come back to that, because I want to hear a little bit about your personal environmental activism and how you have and can use it's so adorable. I can't even tell you.
Well, personally, I've always been a strong. Oh, where'd he go?
I think he's on the wall behind, which is nice. If we
okay.
So personally, I've always been a strong proponent of alternative sources of energy. So. One of the things I did recently is I headed up the town of Old Lyme. We did an initiative for solarize Old Lyme and solarize Old Lyme through the State of Connecticut Energize Connecticut program. And we had a team of volunteers and we ran workshops and helped people throughout the town of Old Lyme actually be able to research, learn about solar energy, and research different vendors, and we helped them to understand and compare different vendors so that they could make selections and put in place some solar energy on their homes. So we had a huge turnout. We had over 130 people at our workshops, and we have a lot of homes in Old Lyme. It's really distracting. I'm trying not to be.
You're doing a great job.
But,
Jake, I'm going to get you to hold him.
Okay.
Because I think that's... Oh! So sweet.
Okay.
You were so charming. I can't believe it. I feel like I should hug you. You're such a good sport.
So we actually Old Lyme converted or helped a large number of homeowners to implement solar energy on their home. And I'm afraid you're going to jump at my glasses.
So this
again.
Is extremely exciting because, you know, there's a solar initiative that they're just costing out here.
Yeah, I know that. And there's some things like, there's the opportunity for, well, where we did Solarize Old Lyme project, there is a Solarize U project as well through the Energize Connecticut. And also, one of the things that's important to me is my carbon footprint. So not only do I have solar on the house, but I drive a completely electric smart car. That's my car that I drive every day, everywhere I need to go. It's my primary car, and I...
And you charge it through solar?
I charge it through the solar on my home, yeah.
Lovely. And do you think you'd get most of it done through...
Most of the car? I have
most of the electricity for
most
the car.
Of the electricity in my home and the car is coming from the solar on my home. So,
and even during winter, do you think?
Actually, solar energy works best during the fall and spring, and it's not even that bad during the winter. The summer, the heat actually reduces the efficiency of solar. So I don't know where he is, but
yeah,
it actually reduces the efficiency of solar energy.
Okay.
So
I'm going to give this guy a break, actually.
He's so charming. Wasn't he beautiful?
Yeah. Really.
Oh, yeah, when he jumps right in my face.
He's getting to know you.
So if you want to take a picture of my car, he's right outside.
Yeah, okay, that's a great idea. Gemma, I'm wondering if you can't help me fix him upstairs. This is super interesting.
So one of the things I've been hoping the college will do is put in electric vehicle parking to be able to support cars like mine. When you look across, there are a lot of applications you can look at on your phone that will identify electric vehicle parking or electric vehicle charging stations for you. And there's this huge gap in this area of Connecticut. And on the southeastern side of Connecticut, there's one in New London down by the train station, but there's nothing up here around the college, and which will support that. And one of the limitations of electric vehicles is charging. So I get about 70 miles a day charge. Oh, that guy's not gonna go anywhere.
Yeah.
I get about 70 miles a day on my car, which is enough for me to go back and forth to work, run errands, and in most days is good. But in the winter time, the cold depletes how much battery power I get or how much mileage I get for a charge during the winter. So it makes it difficult for me to drive it here and home during the winter. So I'm hoping in time that the college puts in electric vehicle parking.
So let's propose them on college, on campus. I mean, I can't think of a better time right now with this recent death to be challenging how cars are integrated into the urban environment and whether or not we can change how we change it so that it's safer, safer in terms of damn well killing students, right? And
right.
Safer in terms of, health, right? And the emissions and the,
The health on campus. That's, my car has, zero carbon emissions.
Yeah.
And
zero diesel fumes and zero particulates and zero, it's not actually even coming from the nuclear power plant there, which is another risk.
Well, right? One of the reasons I wanted to go solar and to get the electric car was I personally don't want to see when this, when the nuclear power plant, Millstone, when it ages out, I don't want them to come forward and say, we need to build another one in your backyard. I'd rather do what I can and help my town and neighbors do what they can to reduce our dependence on the nuclear power so that we don't have to build another one.
Okay, so we have got so many things to talk about.
Okay.
that we have to jump on. And we don't have a lot of time. This is quite poised.
I'm thinking, can you put it either on your eyeglasses or your ring or something? Because it's just camouflaged.
Yeah, I see. Actually, can we do one? Because I think you're such a good sport. We're just sitting on the top of your nose like this. Oh, thank you for being a good catch. Okay. Actually, maybe we sit it, you're right, in here.
Where are you?
Does it?
Yeah.
Kind of echo.
You have to have the show the good humor. That,
Can you look a little thing? Can you? Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Great. That was
yeah.
Great.
And actually, I want, again, I think on the top of my head is a kind of little crown.
So I was aghast when I moved here from Utah 4.5 years ago and started work here the next day and was given the pills that you need to take for in case of a nuclear power leak.
No.
So every
really
every
just a little bit of leaf.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, and I have those hanging up.
I'm good. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll just sit. Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think what because. I mean, we could keep
No, I'm
she's
good.
Both,
with,
she's
yeah,
both
no,
kind
you,
of
you want to
very
talk,
charismatic.
Yeah. I'll let you finish up your interview.
Yeah.
I'll wait for you to ask me questions then.
Yeah, well, it's sort of, we can plan. Yeah.
Where should we put one?
I think it's in the black bag in Nadav. Nadav, where's the black rolly bag? If the in the staff room, can you show? Yeah. So a couple of the things that I've been talking to Josh about, because they're about to get the solar thing.
They're about to get it approved.
No, they're about to get the first bids, I think, or response to.
Okay.
From, and one of the things that I hope we can achieve through this is that these kind, the kinds of energy transformations that are critical to do, precisely because this has got nuclear power, precisely because.
Yeah.
There's precisely because you could do a whole lot of micro hydro, precisely because you know solar is viable here
so,
at this latitude.
Solar is viable at almost any latitude,
exactly.
Because and it actually people think because of the winter that it's not as good, but no, it's better because we don't have the leaves. On the homes.
Oh, nice.
So when the leaves are gone in the fall and the spring, you actually generate a substantial amount of power.
Yeah. Yeah. Really interesting. Okay. So one quick thing is.
Yeah, I can mention that. Okay.
The solar, one way to make solar more visible, and they've done electric power plants, this electric charging stations, as solar counters.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
There's a version of a solar line that I've been, that I developed that I think achieves a couple of other things in addition to that. Now, let's see if I'm online now. No, I'll just go online. Niels, do we have a computer online that we can show the solar awning video to?
I don't right now.
I'm going to get on my phone because I just can't register. Actually, if you can get Nadav to register on here.
It's here somewhere.
That one is online.
Yeah.
So a solar awning that.
Yeah. So a solar awning is a. First of all, the awning, by putting it on buildings, so you're reducing heat gain, right?
Yeah.
Which is, you know, you can change the angle with an awning because it's very easy to do because it's
right.
An awning and that's, so you can have it set at a three.
You can track the sun. Okay.
Angles. So that's nice. But the additional thing that I do is remove less than 1% of the material.
Oh, I see your name then.
No.
This is not it.
The next one had her name on it. If
oh,
you go
good.
Back.
Yeah. Yeah, if you just go to my YouTube channel.
Oh, there it is.
And then Yeah, this one. So this is actually, you just remove a little bit of the material for solar, either with amorphous or with, so you have basically have a pinhole effect. And then images of the sun project in through, so you get kind of a, and the way I've done it is we have, as the sun moves across, the animation changes. The image that it's projecting through changes, right? So you have this slow moving animation projecting inside the building, showing you the kind of solar resources that you're capturing on the sun, on the awning. So instead of it being invisible, I don't know if you can see that again. I can show it to you again. So if this is the awning, right?
Yeah.
The idea is that this is the sun moving across the sky.
And right? So you're...
And every time it positions in, it's, you know, these are actually, you can't see them very well because of the resolution of the video, but each of those is a little pinhole of an image of a sun, just like when you see the shadows underneath the tree. It's actually these little round pinhole images of the sun.
And it moves,
Yeah, and so then as the sun moves across and as the shadows, but in this case it's not a shadow, it's a projection from the sun, kind of moves across the room, the image changes.
And that's how the words are changing,
So that... The idea of using solar in that way is to say solar is not just infrastructure that we put on our roofs and we forget about and we don't even know it's there.
Right.
It actually becomes a conversation topic. You can see it's a kind of ambient monitoring. What I'd like to propose for this is the beautiful image, you know, the projecting the image of the Connecticut College tree logo, you know, would be...
Through the awning.
And that makes it visible and wondrous.
But
and
can you capture that energy? So
So it's just a normal solar. The only thing that it works exactly on, you know,
so it has
or
okay, and it has the inverters to convert it to.
It's you know we're just using whatever we could use whatever solar, you know, vendor they
okay.
like. But we, but when they print up, we have to get sufficient number of orders to print it up in such a way that there is a small, area that is tiny, you know, percentage that allows the pinhole effect to work.
Mm-hmm.
And then we can just slide under, students can design different designs and we can slide under the awning on the non-usable side. So it's just a standard solar that I haven't been able to deploy because to make one off, well, I've done a lot of prototypes. We hand assembled the PV that's just gone, and we've done it with amorphous as well.
Mm-hmm.
But with the laser cutters and kits, you know, you can actually develop curricula around them doing different seasonal, you know, animations and produce it as a cultural. Sorry, that's the next video that plays on my channel. It's very annoying, but stop.
And I guess for me, I'm just I think of solar as, to me, when I see it on a roof. Some people say it's ugly. To me, when I see it on a roof, I think future. And so and I think about, you know, how can we help other countries that don't have the infrastructure we have, you know, to have solar to provide their electricity.
But so here's the other thing, is I think solar, and when it comes to solar, it's really good for supporting a digital lifestyle, right? It's not so great for doing washing machines and doing running refrigerators, but if we...
Well, see, for me, it does my whole house.
Yeah, it can be, you know.
Yeah.
But if we were really to effectively design a college campus, right, and this is the idea, how do we really maximize the use of solar? And how do we maximize the use of solar where solar is DC to DC, right? These are all DC. We put solar into the grid, it converts to AC, and then we get 20-40% losses in doing that. Then converts back to recharge our cell phones, our laptops,
we have to convert back to AC. DC, you're another 20-40% losses. You get 20-40% losses. It's, you know, this diffuse resource of solar.
Right.
If we coupled it, you know, through a, you know, a paradigm of these solar awnings, where students are going DC to DC, right? There's batteries there, and they can understand the impedance matching between all electricities are the same, right? It matters if it comes from your the nuclear power plant or the coal-fired power plant, and we can, in fact, design infrastructure differently. Right, we can.
Right,
we
right.
don't have to reinforce the existing economic interests about, you know.
Right, like I still have to connect to the grid. Even though, you know, I may be supplying the grid.
Right. So here's the other big campaign project that I'd love to get your opinion on. And one of the things that we want to exhibit here is something called the Twin Cloud Data Storage.
I don't know if I should do that.
It's the idea that we can do cloud data storage.
We do cloud data storage. We do cloud data backups.
Right. So the idea that, you know, the biggest success in the last 10 years has been the divestment campaign. The divestment campaign to get college campuses to divest from oil and gas and
fossil fuel.
Yeah. And it's given us a taste of power.
I don't know that they have that has been that important at Connecticut College. That's
they do have one group.
They have a group,
right?
But so, not in all. Like there's other issues that surprise me. That, you know.
Well, the thing about, because there is, you know, nationally, there's been more students involved in the divestment campaign than anything else. And that's problematic. I mean, there's lots of problems.
Right.
So what we want to do is actually follow it up with an investment to get away from the negative activism about
that.
Start to talk about what can we do with our local infrastructure now, and how do we invest in the right kind of infrastructure that we want. So tree cloud data storage is this idea that we're giving students the invitation to say that not only can we do data storage in such a way that reduces the energy, you know, expended and the climate control and other things, we can do tree cloud data storage as a series of systems that does. How is cloud data storage so that it actually improves environmental, so it actually builds increasing biodiversity, is a net positive. So this is a kind of paradigm shift from making our infrastructure less bad, which is, you know, a good thing to have been doing.
Yeah.
But can we now shift to making the contemporary infrastructure that we're building and designing actually do good, right? Actually increase water quality, increase. So this is the tree cloud data storage idea that we're exhibiting and trying to, you know, reason why I was really excited to talk to you is try to figure out what can we do on Connecticut College, because the tree is the icon of Connecticut College,
right?
And because this is, you know, the students use the cloud data storage. That's where the Instagram goes. They have no idea that cloud data storage is, you know, as an industry is dirtier than the airline industry combined, all of the airline industry combined, and that it's doubling and it's, you know,
it's growing exponentially because we're storing data.
Yeah,
and
no one opens up their 60,000 family photographs.
Right, and we're just
we're all hoarders.
Well, and then students come with so many electronics these days.
Right.
You know, it used to just be a laptop, a computer. Now it's the computer, and the tablet, and the cell phone, and I imagine you'll see students with watches. And so all of that.
It's cloud data storage. Yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah, so this idea is, can we initiate with this exhibition? How would we design the cloud data storage here so that we actually improve
and shows kind of leadership for, so one thing is there's geothermal, second thing is there's solar initiative.
Right.
The third thing is there are waste energy systems that use paper waste and food waste that generate clean energy, but they also have the co-benefit of generating biochar and anaerobic digest, both of which, biochar is really good for working into the soil,
mm-hmm.
to mobilize heavy metals, lead in the system, because lead in, so anyway, so these are kind of different energy systems that are available to the university. And this is actually really interesting because I think most universities and how cloud data services are, you know, is to externalize, is to make them somewhere else.
Right.
It's not our problem.
Send it somewhere else.
Yeah.
Well, but there's economies of scale.
Exactly.
For us, you know, to send it offsite. There is Amazon, you know, they have economies of scale when it comes to storage, but they are these, you know, huge facilities. And,
yeah, huge, dirty, unaccountable facilities that have got no, you know, people aren't pressuring them in a way that they're pressuring the power station, you know, because
right.
they're not even, and yet they're the ones we're really making decisions on now. So just the ones that are really. Okay, do we have so yeah, so
I'm just trying to think of how could that come to, like, how would that look at Connecticut College?
Yeah, well, could we run this server, this new server room from the geothermal and the sciences building? Is that because I know
I think they're using the geothermal not for electricity generation, but
just for heating and cooling.
Heating and cooling of that building.
Well, let me find out a little bit more about that.
Because
maybe
even
we could couple it to the solar initiative and see if we can run the whole server room off the solar.
That would be interesting because server rooms take considerably less energy these days than they did, you know, 30 years ago, 10 years ago.
And using solid state too, a lot of solid state.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's another big
BSS.
Yeah.
So SSD drives. So, but yeah, it'd be interesting to see. I've just been challenging them for the electric vehicle and seen.
Well, I think we should do that.
The
too.
Lack of reception.
Oh, I see.
that I'd gotten, you know, and I pressured them to sign up for Solarize University because it was funded by the state and they could even get electric vehicle. Parking things here today that would be funded by the state because we have energy credits in the state at Energize Connecticut. Already state.
Yeah.
And so,
how do we work with you on that?
I've been trying to work with Josh and you know, and that's been the challenge is our facilities maintenance folks.
Okay.
You know, so there's technology out there. I mean, solar technology is advanced now. It's a mature technology.
Could we present the solar charging proposal in the exhibition?
Yeah.
And extend it maybe, because we've got a month to figure it out, how we could extend that also to, because if we get a couple of
to generating power to power the data center. Like I generate the power to power my home.
Yes.
And to charge my car.
Yeah.
Let's
do those two things.
I'd love to consider a windmill. I live near the ocean.
Yes.
And you know,
like
why does
hydro right down here? We could have hybrid energy.
Yeah.
Okay. So can we draw this out? I'll be in touch with you Josh, and we'll get a proposal. And the idea would be to exhibit it here, an initial proposal, and then invite people to discuss it. And
yeah. You want my car?
Do
you want
yeah.
to take pictures of my car? Yeah. It's right outside.
Oh yeah, the car.
Thanks so much for coming.
Send a couple of images of your
I have
you
have
my email.
Yeah.
And I have pictures of my car and the solar on my house, right together, because I gave it to the Energizer Connecticut, right on the campaign. Thanks again.
Bye.
Is this going? This looks like it's. Oh, I see. Because it's not. This is not the start thing. Oh, let me do that again.
I just do like removing this.
Yeah, can we actually put that on a chair? Yeah. Maybe grab another chair and.
That one's lower. Should I see if we can get the same height or does it matter?
I can go grab another one.
Maybe the taller, I think the taller size is better.
Can we grab another?
He's gonna grab the dog.
Two of the different, just a few basic people.
You still have the one here.
Yeah.
Do you want me to give you a hand signal, or is that going to annoy you? Like if we have another person showing up in your 10 minutes, or is it, I should just go. You know what I mean? So should I just, if you see me go like this, that means 5 more minutes and try to wrap it up. And I'll give you that if you're 5 minutes over, I'll wait till, right? Is that how you want?
The frog's back in the bag.
So if you guys want to take a seat in with your back.
We're getting a better, we're getting another stool.
You're getting another stool.
We're getting an adult-sized stool for you, but yes. For now you can.
That's right.
Yeah. Nice.
It's a psychological test. The psychological test.
And Jemba, leave on my boot. You know, it's got the very nice. Yeah, leave it on.
Just take a photo.
Very lovely.
Trying to get good hands and
yes, a video through this.
That kind of sums it up.
Because that's at the moment that's just getting. Yeah, he's getting the chair to capture the interactions. And he also is grabbing here. Just maybe pull the.
I mean, I hate. Oh,
I was grabbing the other phone. The video with the
hangouts. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, we can do it that way. So we are recording, and actually, we'll just kind of converse while we're. Introducing you to these organisms that cohabit with
organisms of those.
Well, this is a lunar moth cocoon. So, do you know the lunar moth? Have you seen them around this area?
No, not since I was a child.
Really?
I have a very vivid memory when I was a small child. We had a lunar moth stuck on our screen. And it was huge, and my dad took all these photographs of it, and it's just a big thing. Yeah.
Well, we hope to do some. Maybe this one.
It's a letter.
Given that we have a, it's not very safe actually.
Don't move. It's sort of like can you walk with the hand?
Well done.
Wow, this is a
yeah, they're great little builders.
Okay, well, I'm introducing
a folder. He's folded himself into a leaf.
There's three different moths that we have that cocoons. So Gemma, can you pull them over? And we'll take photographs of it. As we are introducing you and taking photographs. So, you know, the idea of the exhibition is to kind of pose this question, how do we individually, collectively, and institutionally redesign our relationship with the ecosystem in order to improve human environmental health, which I would argue is a challenge in the century, right? Political, institutional,
individual as well, because I mean,
yeah.
The students are really interested in, you know, what can they do on an individual level,
yeah,
or sort of organize students to all do something. I know in my class they've been talking about consumption a lot.
Yeah, I mean, the very first thing I want to say to those things is it's really actually not that complicated.
Right.
You just have to be willing to buy almost nothing, you know, like
right. Just
buy less
right.
stuff.
Buy less.
Yeah, so that's one form of agency, but I, you know, the exhibition, I think, you know, the kind of transforming energy systems and transforming systems in the light
yeah.
of this recent tragedy, transforming how we do cloud data storage, which is what I was just talking to her about, is our current infrastructure, which is dirtier than the entire airline industry, and we're making decisions about it now, and the whole rhetoric is about let's increase the energy efficiency. No, let's actually redesign and actually the students, these meals in Jamboree, where they have a student movement called the Invest Campaign or the Divest Campaign, which is, I think, given students in this
yeah.
now to do something, but actually for positive activism to get beyond, you know, there is the responsible consumer movement, but by definition, students can't buy a lot of Prius cars and they can't buy a lot of Teslas. And, you know, they're
coming out of school though. That's the thing.
They
are preparing. Most of the students I work with in that class are seniors, and they talk a lot about what cars they're buying
yeah.
know, 6 months
right.
from now.
Right.
Okay. So it's sort of preparing them for this independent life that they haven't done it yet.
Right. Exactly. So it's developing their rhetoric. They kind of, if we think. I'm sorry,
little one.
I think you're okay.
I hope there's not shake a baby syndrome for cocoons.
Is this one still going to hatch, or is this still
you will.
Okay.
Deal,
no,
will.
No. I'm just wondering.
It's not.
Sort of
there's
a,
no
animals
going to
be remnant.
Kind
of thing, right?
There's no animals.
We're hoping they'll hatch while.
Well, that would be very nice.
I can't promise I won't. So the idea of the exhibition is that we can use it as the opportunity. Yes.
Hopefully, that's a good one. Oh, I can hear it. That is really strange.
Oh my God. He's squealing. Would you like to feel him? It's pretty amazing. I can hear him. Oh, he's coming out of the bottom. I just felt it.
He's really working on it, isn't he? I'll be right now.
It's like Jurassic Park. He's supposed to overwinter. He's actually not supposed to.
I know, well, a little shake and there go up.
Sorry, I didn't.
Oh, that's wow.
He's loud. Wow. He's really
like a microphone. He's like mic'd.
Yeah.
So cool.
I thought I felt something on the bottom.
Well, so you can imagine. I'm conscious of time.
Yes.
We will be
Yeah.
So one of the ideas of the exhibition, I mean, I think that responsible consumer movement is great, but you know,
it's individual, right? And it's not going to the politics and structures.
Your nomination to the Doctors, which is the advisory board for the is based on your agency. What kind of
the frog is in the bag. I'm not sure.
So your own lifestyle expertise relevant to how we can use Connecticut College as an opportunity. Because I think the colleges, as you know, they should show the intellectual leadership, they should be experimenting, they should be places where students are figuring out new lifestyle. Then we're not preparing them for you know, them into society. We are actually defining the kind of society they are now here. We're exploring, developing, understanding, you know, if we can figure out how to transform our biggest village here. Mm-hmm. Then of course they go and can use that experience to transform their workplace. So it's gonna the intellectual leadership has been raising death from Connecticut College and how we can do more radical
It's one of the things we'll talk about at the college. We don't have a time to actually plan right now. So we said we were going to develop one, and then it fell off the agenda. And so all of the different pieces of a climate action plan, we've never put it together. And so I've got students who are thinking about that. I've also made the suggestion to FSCC that they get the opportunity.
Yes, so let's go back and make sure that we get the introduction of what your role at the university and this sort of the introduction for the recording. We are recording some. Is the recording going?
It's
going.
I'm just trying to get my phone on it.
And do you think we can get some stickier double-sided tape? Could we ask Nadav if we can get some stickier? Is this double-sided tape?
I have this, but it's too sticky.
It would never come off.
Well, actually, yeah. Well, let's try it with a little bit of. What about that's electrical tape?
Yeah.
No, I don't think that's actually going to be sticky enough either.
Oh, I think it will be.
You think?
Yeah. But you might see it. It's, we need to cut it very small.
I'd like it to, like.
Could we put it?
You want like.
There's a cigar it thing.
Yeah, on your next to the scarf, I think. I think this here
You can make it a bed here.
I think it is, but just not so much because we don't want to see the table.
Yeah. Right. I took a little cocoon slime.
Well, it's an idea. So I was just thinking it can actually sit.
Because you seem
I just think you're gonna see it.
Brand.
Oh, that's nice.
Okay, so if you can just introduce yourselves and your research and your the question of the Doctors Without Disciplinary Borders is how does your expertise apply locally? Because we typically apply our own expertise to our communities of expertise and our academic fields. How do we? What extent is our knowledge useful for local transformations? Mm-hmm. Human and environmental health.
Right.
Yes. Well, you started talking about working with students.
Well, okay, so I'm Jane Dawson, and I'm the director of the Goodwin Urey Center for the Environment. It's a center with about 20 faculty, including myself, and it also has, we accept 10 certificate students per year. So we're like the animal center. We have about
32.
Yeah.
So it's very selective.
It's very selective. They have to have an idea of how they're going to bring the environment into their major and do something really interesting with it. They start their sophomore year, they do internships, and they do senior year projects and do honors studies. They take special classes so that they'll know more about this. We have people from theater, we have people from math, we have people from English. It's just every department, which is really very cool.
Said no to other students.
Okay, and they all really do go on to do something environmental and get out. They've become very environmentally driven and centered, and their careers, you know, it's really rare that their career doesn't have an environmental component in it. So I do that. I'm also a faculty member in the Gov department and in environmental studies.
Yeah, that's great. Okay. Well, could we do the other earring or no?
We can do both. We've got plenty of. This is the Okay, but we got that one of
yeah,
yours.
We got that.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So I've also worked on faculty, staff, committees, the environment. And I'm working with a group of students, faculty, staff.
Okay, we have this idea is good.
He's resting right now. We might do more on climate.
Right. And your own?
My own work has to do with the industrial agriculture and meat, and looking at the carbon footprint of meat as well as the animal welfare issues with it, trying to understand. I don't know what's happening there. Trying to understand why environmental groups and animal welfare groups don't work together to have something that's more environmentally sustainable and humane at the same time.
So interesting.
Yes. So
the coupling of the
it's environment,
human and environment.
Right. So I'm very interested actually in animals and how we treat them and their impact on the environment and also how people don't see what they eat as something, an animal that has a life and an environmental impact and all of those things. Mm-hmm. So right now I've been working on comparisons of climate denial and CAFO denial. And
what's that?
CAFO, concentrated animal food operations.
Yes.
So the big factory farm. Yeah. People who don't realize what they're eating, or they do, but they're in denial, just like they're in denial about climate change.
Right.
And so if you use theories of denial, you can apply the same theories of denial on climate change to what we're eating.
Interesting.
So, and we have managed.
So how do you treat denial?
There are different kinds of denial. So one of the things is, you know, so denial of the facts. And one of the things we're discovering with climate change and meat is it's really not denial of the facts. There's so that would be what we call literal denial.
It's denial of the moral responsibility,
that
or
denial that it's implicatory denial is what they call it. Denial that you have to actually act on the implications of what you know. So
right,
the knowledge is
right
there, but you're not acting on it. It's
yes, that's interesting.
Truths.
I call it the crisis of agency. That's
uh-huh.
What you mean, that
yes, but you're not doing anything about it, even though you know.
Well, what do I do? Right, it's not actually that you don't want to. It's just that
well,
it's very hard to do something.
But here
the
students
good.
Know that,
right.
For instance, if you cut down meat once a week, red meat, it's more than buying a Prius for you. Your carbon footprint goes down by more than if you just gone out and spent $25,000-$30,000 on a hybrid car.
Right.
So all you have to do is cut one hamburger a week to have more impact. So you're saving money, it's good for your health, it's easy to do, and we haven't been able to get meatless Monday going on campus at all.
That's
because
surprising.
The athletes particularly have rebelled against it.
Hmm.
They say this is just
right.
Not acceptable, that they need their meat. So there's talk right now about educating students about protein sources that aren't meat.
Right.
But I mean, that's something that's beyond consumption.
Right.
It's just you know, one hamburger a week.
Right.
It's just such a small thing to do. We're not asking them to have a whole lot of agency back.
Wow, that's actually interesting. We're done with this very poised, kind of curious.
And that huge possibly
actually
completely vegetarian.
It's such a myth.
I'm wondering if we couldn't actually do, because one of the things is sports, I think, is a really interesting opportunity for re-choreographing our relationship to natural systems, both in how we use green spaces and what they're designed for.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering if we couldn't actually have, set up a race between a vegetarian athlete and a non-vegetarian athlete and recruit and train them
it's interesting.
As part of the exhibition to kind of really spectacularize this one particular issue, which seems...
And then what happens when the vegetarian
We rig the game. We rig the game.
We have to rig the game.
Yes. Yes. And, you know, the rest of the you know, we know that rigged and we design it, we can take bets.
I think I'm gonna have some trouble with this. What's interesting too is my students in the Goodwin Nearing Center, we just study fisheries and the lack of sustainability of fisheries. By the end of the semester, we were going to have a pop-up dinner where everybody brought something sustainable and was going to be something sort of seafood oriented. By the end of the semester, all the students decided there is no sustainable seafood. All the options are bad. And they had all gone vegetarian too. So the entire potluck. So it was 17 students. There was no meat.
Fantastic.
We do have one.
When was that?
Last week at my house.
Fantastic.
So I have them cook what they think is sustainable and come and explain it to the class.
So
what's sustainable about it?
Right.
And everybody has their own definition about sustainable.
Right. So one of the things that I'm trying to shift a little bit, a personal thing about sustainability as a frame. I don't find it at all useful. It doesn't kind of demand a kind of creative agency. It doesn't kind of social and environmental transformations. They're apologetic at small scale. They kind of, this is not hard. It's that whole kind of small.
It's win-win-win. So sustainability with environment and social and economic, it's, you can win on all three, and then you're sustainable because you've got those three circles or whatever. But what about the things you need to do to save the planet that are not really win-win? On campus, there are a lot of things we haven't done because it costs too much.
Right.
And so you can't get to win-win-win, so we just don't do it.
Well, yeah. So one of the other ideas that I took on, this exhibition project is called Open Market, right? And so the exhibition, as we're planning it, and as your advisors, and we'll be staging workshops and discussions about Open Market. And again, it's about shifting the discourse to more radical transformation. So one of the Open Market projects to do with it's got to do with re-establishing relations with Cuba, and I'm calling it the Cuban Muscle Crisis, actually, which because
I haven't done like across Cuba.
Sorry,
I hiked across Cuba.
You did?
The West Coast.
Okay, so the project that we hope to initiate.
Okay.
Sorry.
Go. No, it's okay. I'm going to be here till 1:00, so.
Yes, I know. Well, you are. Well, yeah, I'm going to show you this particular, because we'll be exhibiting this new pier called the Pier to Pier. Establishing a pier in Cuba and a pier here, because it's a port city, and this was redesigning and reimagining our relationship between the terrestrial and the aquatic. The pier is actually really interesting in it. So this is the Pier to Pier, which is a 1,000 times cheaper and 100 times stronger than a conventional pier. As you know, it's made out of ECTFE and tensile material with no pylons. It's just tension and buoyancy as it goes to rigidity and mass.
So we take catastrophic plating mode. And the interesting thing about it is that these submerged cryotrods have a, this is a muscle work. So because this is transparent, the biogeo can, the solar goes through, it promotes algae photosynthesis and other
things. I'm sorry, what is this?
Sorry,
it's a pier.
A radically new. It's about the exhibition is about getting concrete examples about more radical transformations that we can do. You know, to get beyond this sustainability discourse into how do we really creatively reimagine our energy. So the way the pier works is it's again it's radically less expensive. Has no catastrophic failure mode. It's not a big rigid mass that will jam into it, you know, with the storm surge scene. It also has this muscle rope underneath it because the light can go through. In here is a desalination plant, so the hydrological cycle. It's a water pillow that is the flotation pillow. Also, the water evaporates, condenses, and then runs down the side so that it becomes flex on here, so we have a slow, passive desalination. But the other thing is, this is a muscle work here that has a bio-oscillator. And the bio-oscillator, you know, it's a wave energy generator. So it gets more efficient as the muscles grow, which is one of the interesting forms of aquaculture that the FAO would say is viable in so much as there's a lot of debate about how low down the food chain, but actually fostering and cultivating mussels improves water quality. In this case, we're combining conventional mussel rope farming with energy, clean energy generation. So as the mussels swim, it electrically generates energy as well, and it gets more efficient. Most of the wave energy generation techniques actually, they do all this anti-fouling work because they get fouled, which this is, as they get fouled, it gets more efficient, right? It actually promotes growth. So this is an example of mutualistic system design works. We'll be exhibiting here. We'll talk about radically new paradigm shifts in designing waterfront, building one here, building one here. This is a question, but you know, on the shoreline somewhere. I'm building one in Cuba, and there's a sail freight project. The main sail freight project will be exhibiting here too. The Cuban sail freight project we're about to initiate through this open exhibition. We'll be kind of proposing this as a way to distribute the Vermont sail freight project through, you know, the other owners working and developing and is ongoing. So anyway, this is one example of taking some of what we're doing at the exhibition and saying, here are some, so I find participatory processes, getting people to design. If you give them something concrete, to be able to say, I've got a mini version for that, you know, and be able to say, no, that's not going to work here, or it could work here, or we could adapt it to the scale, or I know the person who would really like that, who was a muscle farmer, but you know, that being able to make it work locally is the idea of what this exhibition can do. And what did we get? Can you stay for a little bit more and we can talk?
Yes, I'm a worker. Yes. Yeah.
Thought this was
a nice 12:30. So I'm Rachel Spicer. I'm a professor in the botany department. And I'm a fellow at the Guggenheim Center. My research is not terribly related to environmental conservation issues at all. It's extremely applied. I study Earth's extremely fundamental and not applied. I study very processes in trees. It's not how trees grow.
I think it's got everything to do with
it. It's all related. But I don't do this for complaining. But I am very personally interested in it. And I teach a course on biofuels and how we can generate fuels from materials. So I work with students in environmental realms quite a bit. I have very strong feelings about this, and I'm very sensitive to the high technology focus to environmental conservation. And actually, we'll continue to say, if you want to talk about radical solutions, people have to start willing to live quite differently and purchase less stuff. Buy fewer things, wash your clothes a lot less frequently, own fewer clothes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There are really essential things that people can do.
Can you swap places over here and sit?
Here's the microphone.
It's not telling what time
it is. Yeah, it is.
Okay.
10:15.
Yeah, so I mean, this is actually a really interesting debate, and I'm of course on the other side, because I deal with suicidal students all the time who have this logic that the only real way to be an environmentalist is to, both sides of the people are running from. I don't mean the best thing for me to do would be to suicide.
That's turning into mental illness.
This is something. It's a logical extension of the best thing we can do is to do less.
Certainly,
is to consume less and to do. That is certainly a viable, but it's not the extent of what the creative agency, the scientific and knowledge transformations that we can do. And it's one that I actually find that I'm always on the other side, because of course I think that we can radically redesign food systems so that they not only do less damage and so therefore eating less and having less children is the good, but we can actually design food systems that build soil, increase biodiversity.
And this is
the kind of rhetoric that I find much harder. There's much more skepticism, there's much more, we've already given up. It's already over. Climate change is happening.
Students here have given up. I mean, students in the Environmental Studies program, we're going to go out and save this place. They're very much, your generation messed it up, and it's up to our generation to fix it. And I think a lot of them feel pretty empowered by the time they come out. I don't think many of them feel that it's hopeless. We could pair us in classes, and students are like, okay, it's not enough, but it's a game changer. We're going to follow through on it.
I just get the post-COP21 depression. I don't know if you're dealing with it, but frankly,
I was in terms of
one of the issues that I really wanted to talk with you about is the idea of the student-initiated project, again, away from, emphasizing what the exhibition will emphasize is ways in which we can redesign systems that increase shared human environmental health. Right? That's the paradigm of this particular show. So, I mean, there's plenty of places to talk about. No impact man is a very good friend of mine. It's all sorts of, the Meatless Monday. I mean, these things exist, but there isn't good ways in which socio-ecological, algorithmic, mutualistic systems design is being articulated. There's not a single course in it. I'm the only, person who argues for mutualistic systems design and urban infrastructure. So it's a really, a thing that I really care about.
Environmental engineering and design, environmental sound design programs. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I know all of the environmental engineering programs, mm-hmm. and the history of environmental engineering professor, most of them come out of chemical engineering and industrial plant design. And if you want to be an environmental engineer in this country, that's actually either do environmental studies, which is kind of more liberal arts dominated, or you do environmental engineering, which comes out of chemical plant design. Mm-hmm. Even at the Yale School of Forestry, where I was a professor for 5 years, there's no systems design.
there's no NSF funding, there's, you know, socioecological descriptive science, you know, which is great work, but that's not applied to any infrastructure design. You know, there's a whole lot of ways in which there is, you know, one master's program in designing with nature, which is an apologetic program at Delft University that is about, you know, that we should use living systems in our infrastructure design, which is, again, you know, the rhetoric about green infrastructure that, you know, it's all cut and paste, there's not research money for it, there's not, I mean, I actually,
I guess I don't understand what you're saying is how you're delineating this area that's completely absent.
Mutualistic systems design.
So can you define that for me?
Mutualistic systems design comes, you know, is, for instance, the peer project that I showed you, which, I mean, can look gadgety, right? I can tell you the Cubans.
And it could be fantastic.
You know, but if you look at how the longer history that we have co-evolved with mussels, and that mussels and the high EPA and DHA levels, probably the reason why we have a neocortex like we have, you know, whatever. So the idea of human populations have thrived where there's been these mega metropolises of and geological scale of these living piles, right? We find history, a much more viable than the percent on the plains with guys and their spears and getting the, you know, the only, you know, whatever. How have we co-evolved and worked in these shoreline societies or the unshoreline to really look at systems which have been productive ecologically and for human culture, right? Mm-hmm. So that, as an example, is, distills water, generates clean energy, increases biodiversity, using mussels as a keystone organism that filters water and have, you know, can aggregate to these mass amounts, will filter more water en masse than the oysters, which have been so celebrated, but also generates energy and is, urban infrastructure simultaneously. So it's a new, completely new demand on what urban infrastructure is, that it has to, you know, a bridge, and the bridge that we're designing for here, there is, in London, there's the Garden Bridge that's been a big competition that, Lumley, you know, did, and all the big star architectures put in a bridge, and this guy, Heatherwick, who did the Olympic ceremony, designed the new Garden Bridge, which is a big concrete bridge decorated with a bit of garden on the top, and it's huge. It's already 40% over budget, and it's not even final design stage, etc. So because we're in London, it's kind of a big international, what is the state of the art of bridge design now? And I would argue that in New London, as opposed to London, we could have a new garden bridge as opposed to the current garden bridge.
So there's a bridge that's being designed here?
That will exhibit a bridge here that embodies, again,
a design of a bridge.
We're proposing a bridge here in this exhibition that will hopefully bring in the people from the Coast Guard Academy and local government officials to say, actually, bridges in the 21st century can not only be a route from A to B, and not only be a tourist destination, you know, but they also have to improve water quality, create habitat, be radically less expensive, and perform in extreme weather conditions of, you know, with these pylons that aren't big concrete things. So, you know, proposing a concrete alternative that the new garden bridge, you know, embodies this mutualistic systems design where we can say here the seagulls are benefiting, there is shoreline redevelopment that aggregates over, you know, the next 50 years, here are the flow models, we are creating habitat, you know, et cetera. We go through the benefit analysis of all the, which is very different from how the bridge discussion is being held in the public interest. And, you know, so that's being able to posit that the big design challenge of the 21st century, the space race of the 21st century, that should attract the best and brightest like your program does, isn't, you know, the technology isn't always and already bad. I mean, and most of the discussion around, you know, this changes everything, and the recent film that the book, Naomi Klein book.
Oh, I was in the film.
It's, she's wonderful. Yeah, but the design discourse is impoverished, right? It's, oh, we've got big solar and we've got big wind. Well, big solar and big wind have most of the same problems that the, you know, they're high capital cost, they are not, you know, big wind has got all sorts of anti-fouling agents that are used to with the offshore, you know, so, and they have so many of the same problems in terms of centralized power distribution, as, yeah. And there's no articulation of what distributed local power production looks like. How do we make it? So the reason why what was the first book that I, when Nadav started talking about this, I got very excited about, because I would argue that that we need metrics. We need metrics that are biologically meaningful for human health. And in the sort of smart city realm, that the number one human health issue is air quality, implicated in asthma, cardiovascular health, heart attacks, breast cancer epidemic, diabetes, everything, right? So it is, and we have one demonstrated technology for improving urban air quality, is leaves, leaf air index. And that what is interesting about this campaign that I was talking to the IT person about, this to follow up the divestment campaign with the students around the world, doing quite successfully, most successful in America, 300 campuses have divested. And it was probably one of your students who was the divestment people here. To follow that up with an investment campaign that is investing in viable, you know, one of the big ideas of the 21st century is waste energy systems, right? How do we couple the biggest waste streams from the open campus, paper waste and feed waste that can both be, you know, on, you know, feedlots. Food waste can produce methane as a clean energy, you know, and anaerobic digest, which does a, you know, tenfold reduction of materials. Paper waste can do a pyrolysis and can produce biochar in addition to. So, and biochar and the organic anaerobic digest makes a perfect soil building technology that we can immobilize lead and mercury and heavy metals and ubiquitous in urban soils. We can have these tremendous co-benefits where we are generating energy in such a way that it improves local environmental health. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the idea of running the investment campaign is around investing in tree cloud data structure, data storage, which is to say that the current infrastructure decisions that we're making about data infrastructure could be about us students asking to invest in their current infrastructure. It's much harder to change the nuclear power plant and the, you know, to ask for decisions about the current infrastructure to be made. They want data infrastructure that improves environmental health as opposed to degrades human and environmental health. Or the current rhetoric of sustainability, which is to do less damage.
I'm gonna have to
So leaf area index is what I think is the key
best metric for the to hold cities and campuses accountable to something that's biologically meaningful, which is why tree cloud is in effect not about
carbon footprint.
That's this data storage, tree cloud data storage, and post cloud storage that actually improves human environmental health, and it's indexing the data storage capacity to the leaf area index. And the leaf area index that I really want to talk to you about further is because we have LIDAR, satellite LIDAR, and the cities have terrestrial LIDAR. And so we can pull the leaf area index out and then say, you know, make our cities and our campuses. This is the metric of success. So I think everything is about links, right? And growth phenomena and building soil.
Indices out there about trees in cities and which cities are the most planted in trees.
But not a
but it's not a that's a tricky.
It is, but it's not canopy complexity. It is very much like the mini tree project. You know, decorative trees, even if it's based along the ground. You know, trees is decoration and not. Leaf area index we can get at, you know, it's a better proxy for biodiversity than counting trees, right? It's actually about many of the other strategies. So
but the next step would be to increase the leaf area.
Exactly.
Which we already know.
Right. And that's what that's if we've got a good metric, leaf area index from LIDAR, we can, 5 years, we want a tenfold increase in leaf area index in campus, right? You know, set a reasonable. Anyway, so this is what I'd love to talk to you further about and get more. I think this is the big.
test.